Okay, so welcome everybody to this virtual meeting from Center of Complexity and Biosystems. A few advice before we start. This session will be recorded, and please switch off your microphone and keep it switched off during the presentation. And if you have any question, you can wait until the end of the meeting, so you can ask to the speaker. But if there is something very urgent that you need to ask during the presentation, please write in the chat and I will stop and ask the speaker for you. So our speaker today is Linda Rabazzano. She's a second year PhD student and she's working now for the Center of Complexity in Biosystems. She made her master thesis at Leiden University and she's working on active matter. And today she will talk about unjamming of active rotators. So please, Linda, if you can start share your screen.
Thank you very much. Okay, so you see the slide. Thank you very much for the presentation. And so today we are speaking about unjamming of active rotators. And in particular, we are going to speak about our last paper that has been published at the end of May on soft matter. And so let's start from the title of this paper. So what does we mean with unjamming of active rotators? First of all, let's focus on the word active, because as also Maria said in the introduction, I work in the field of active matter. And what does we mean with active matter? For active matter, we mean a system composed of self-driven units, so active particles. That means that each particle is able to take energy from the surrounding environment and transform it in systematic movement. This is the example of a lot of biological systems. For example, let's think to cells that can transform the nutrients in movement, and let's think to the algae. They can transform the energy from the sun via photosynthesis to perform their motion and to migrate. Let's think to fish. A school of fish is an example of active matter because they can transform the energy from food in their movement. So all these kind of biological system have this ability to self-propel themselves. So, but from the physical point of view, the interesting stuff is that active matter is an example of far from equilibrium system, meaning that these particles have the ability of self-propel. They don't are simply on thermodynamic equilibrium with the surrounding, but they can show a variety of collective property and emerging behaviors. For example, it has been studied that if you have a system composed of active particles and you confine it in a geometry, these particles tend to slide along a wall. For example, this is the example of a circular shape in which they form a vortex-like behavior, and this is due to their activity. You won't observe the same if you are just considering passive particles. And the same happens also for when you look at phase transition. For example, you can see here in this slide an example of phase transition in which you consider the phi, the density, and the Peclet number, that is a measure of the activity of the particle. You can see that activity, for example, can cause phase transition, the formation of cluster, and a different behavior of what we will observe in a passive system. Furthermore, when you consider the trajectory of this active particle, you have something different from what you would expect for a passive one, that is subject to thermodynamical equilibrium, so just to thermal noise, they will perform random walk. But when you have an active particle, the behavior is different. And this is nice because it has been observed in a variety of different species. For example, here at the beginning of the slide, you can see this the trajectory of a larva of Drosophila, so a fly, looking for food. And if you're looking at this, you can see some pattern emerging. For example, these search strategies are optimized to looking for food or resources, and they form inactive particles. So such can be the fly larvae, but also the, for example, the dictyostelium motion, that is a unicellular organism, but also big animals like sharks and birds form these regular patterns that can be modeled, for example, like levy flights, that is a kind of random walk in which basically you alternate short and long step, so not all the steps are the same. And this is mathematically the best walk to search for sources that you don't know where they are. And this has been observed in a variety of animals, like we said. And so that has been the base to build models for active matter trajectory. The main ingredient is to take into account the self-propulsion of these active particles. And usually in the model, the self-propulsion is added considering constant velocity at each step of the particle that is applied in the same direction the particle was already moving. This is because you have to take into account, for example, when you think to a cell, something movement, that you have a characteristic time before the particle is rearranging to turn and to change direction. And this time is the persistent time before you randomly change direction due to rotational diffusion. So in this kind of models, what you have basically is that you have this self-propulsion, so applied like a constant force to your active particle that continually self-propel the particle, and then you can randomly change direction via the rotational diffusion. But if we go ahead with our paper, we said that we want to deal with rotators. This is because if you observe in nature, you have way rich behavior than only self-propelled particle like before. And so, for example, from the observation of these micron-sized alga, that is Chamidomonas reinhardi, that is a unicellular alga, very common and very studied as a model, you can see that this alga, because of his structure, so this alga has a high spot sensitive to light that is located near the cell equator. And so what does this alga does during its life? Basically, it wants to look for sunlight to perform photosynthesis. But since the sensitive eye spot is located in a precise point, to maximize the probability of finding sunlight, they turn around. So basically they self-rotate to better scan the surrounding space. So this kind of particle are not only simply active particle, meaning that they can self-propel performing translational motion, but they perform also single particle rotation, so each alga can rotate around its center. And as you can see from the video, so you have something different from simply self-propelled particle, because you have, yes, the self-propulsion, but in addition, you have a new ingredient to add to our active particle model. So you have to take into account also self-rotation. To do so, we performed some experiments on Chlamydomonas reinhardi in a top medium at different densities and stress condition. To start from this natural example of active rotator with the idea of adding this ingredient to the active particle models. And then the last word of our title, to have a completely perspective of what we did, so unjamming. This is because we focused in a particular phase transition, that is the jammed-unjammed phase transition. This kind of phase transition is typical of granular material. And what happens is that when the density of a granular material is low, typically your granular material behaves like a fluid. Then if you increase the density, you have a transition to a jammed state in which your granular material behave like a solid. So you have a limited mobility and slow relaxation time. As you can see also from the phase diagram by Duhenegger, the famous phase diagram by Duhenegger, this is something that has very similarity to the glassy transition. The difference is that now what drives the transition is the density, while in the glassy transition it's something that is guided by temperature. But why we want to focus on this specific kind of phase transition? Well, because this jammed and jammed transition has been observed to occur in active matter systems that are of biological interest. So very far from the simply granular materials we see in the previous slide. For example, we have two meaningful examples in this slide. So one is the study of human bronchial epithelial cell. This is a study that regards the patient with asthma. So what they observe is that increasing the pressure, that is something that happens typically during a bronchospasm, for example, the cells of the bronchial epithelial tissue undergo a jammed unjammed transition. So increasing the pressure, they go to an unjammed state, they fluidize. And this happens differently in patients with asthma and not. So this can say as something about this pathology, for example. The other example is here, and in this example, they study cancer cell, and they see how from a wound healing experiment, a transition can occur due to boundary conditions. So basically, if you have a confluent cell, then you do a scratch, basically, and you have a wound. This led transition from a jammed to unjammed state, and again the system fluidized. So here we can see example of biological active matter system in which this kind of transition occurs. And so having in mind this, the question we wanted to answer when we projected this paper basically is, what is the role of self-rotation on a jammed state, and can it lead to a phase transition? To do so, the first thing we did is to build a model in order to perform a molecular dynamics simulation of active matter. And we started writing the equation of motion for b-dimensional disk. And so we write both the part regarding the translational part and the rotational one. But we have the same ingredients. So let's go ahead through our model. The first thing that we have to take into account is that our active self-rotating and self-propelled particle move in a viscous medium. So what we have is a friction term that enters both the center of mass equation and the angular one. So the first term takes into account the friction and is proportional in one case to the velocity and in the other one to the angular velocity. And since often in the case of cell we are moving in an overdamped regime, we take the parameter B, that is a damping parameter, we take this such that we are in an overdamped regime, so that we reached the Brownian dynamics through an overdamped Langevin dynamics. The other term we have to consider and to take into account is a random term typically of Brownian motion, because our active particles are in any case moving randomly. And those terms are proportional to the temperature via the fluctuation dissipation theorem. And so our particles are performing Since now our particles are simply performing Brownian motion, but we want to deal with active particles, so we have to add the active terms. The first one takes into account the self-propulsion. So basically, the self-propulsion is something already studied. You have as we see before, we have a constant modulus, a velocity that a force that is constant in modulus and then is proportional to the velocity, meaning that a particle is forced to move in the same direction it was moving before. But then in the rotational part, and this is the novelty of our model, we add this active torque. So basically, to model the self-propulsion at each step of our simulation, we are adding a constant torque to each particle. But we are considering the sign of the rotation. So basically, we, in analogy with what we did with self-propulsion, we are adding a positive or negative torque according to the previous value of the angular velocities of our rotators. And then, since we want not only to study a single and isolated particle, but we want to study in a system of jammed interacting particles, we have to take into account the interaction among them. And so we have those terms that are coming from the Hertzian interaction that we are considering. In this case, as we can see, there's an interaction. We have a normal component that is normal to the contact surface of the two interacting particles and the tangential one. In the normal one, we have both a term that is proportional to overlapping and has an elasticity factor, so basically a repulsive factor, and then a viscoelastic damping factor. So you are accounting a sort of friction. And the same happens in the tangential direction, in which you have a shear effect and then again a viscoelastic damping factor. But this is not all, because since we are studying the system of interacting particle, but with having in mind what happens in the cell system, basically, an ingredient that is always present in the biological system is the adhesion. So we also want to add an adhesion term eventually to our equation, and we did this by using the Degerbrunn-Müller-Toporov model. In this model, we have this term of adhesion that is proportional to the Amacker constant, that is a constant for the strength of the pair-pair interaction. Is proportional to the effective radius of the two interacting particles, and here C is the least possible distance among the two contact surfaces. Basically, this term acts as a spring term when two particles overlap, so attracting them when they overlap. And this is to model the adhesion. So now that we have built this model, we have to run the simulation using this, so implement this in our simulation. And to perform our molecular dynamic simulation, we use the LAMPS, that is a molecular dynamic simulator already optimized for parallel computing. We start with particle in random initial configuration, and we span different densities, different value of the parameter. What we did, as having in mind the equation of motion we have before, we integrate this equation of motion, updating position and velocity of particle at each step of our simulation. We did this for a system of bidispersed particle, and this is because we want to avoid crystallization, basically. So in analogy what already done with other study in packing of dense particle, we choose to use a bidispersed radius. We study a system of 1,000 of particles, so to have enough statistics, let's say, and covering 100 time units, so we observe that for a quite long time. And since we are interested in how the self-rotation behaves, basically, we didn't take into account temperature, meaning that all the particles we simulated are subject to the same thermal noise, basically. And so, using all this stuff, we perform our simulation with LAMPS after, of course, a bit of debugging, and then we start having the first results. We start from low density simulation. So we start with a packing fraction, that meaning a ratio between the volume occupied by the particle and the volume of the box simulation that is quite low, so it's a dilute regime. And we observe what happens when we switch on or off the cohesion. And this is interesting because, as you can see from those two videos, when the cohesion is off, the particle just fluctuates due to the thermal noise, but there is no much interaction in the dilute regime. And instead, when you switch on the cohesion, you have the formation of cluster. And if you zoom in looking at the single cluster, the rotating particles are forming, you see that those clusters are rotating. So this is interesting because we observe this collective rotational behavior, basically, of the particle in this regime. But even more interesting is the fact that if we observe the Chlamydomonas reinhardi, that is our example of natural rotators, what we observe is again the formation of rotating cluster. And this is interesting because what we perform in the experiment is to perform experiment on simple Chlamydomonas reinhardi on the dilute regime, and then to add NaCl basically as a stress factor. So when the algae are stressed, they tend to aggregate and to form a cluster, as we can see from this bar plot. And if we, from the particle image velocimetry, we can reconstruct the velocity distribution and the angular velocity distribution of those particles. And we can see that in the case of the velocity distribution, we have a Rayleigh-like distribution, while in the case of the angular velocity, we have a Gaussian-like distribution. And if we then go to compare what we obtain from the low density experiment with the low density simulation, is very interesting because what we observe is that the shape of the velocity distribution are basically the same. And so you can see the shape of both the linear velocity and the angular velocity are very similar. And then even more interesting is the fact that there is a parallelism between the stress condition and the switch on the cohesion. So basically, in the experimental case, we have the formation of a rotating cluster when the algae are stressed, and in the simulation when the cohesion is on. This suggests the fact that the stress implies in the algae a sort of looking for each other, so a sort of adhesion to happen when they are stressed. So comparing those results can ensure us that our model can capture some important feature of some unnatural rotators, such as the Chlamydomonas reinhardi. Starting from that, so starting from this confirmation in the dilute regime, we want to move a step further, investigating how the self-rotation affect the phase behavior in a denser regime. So we want to move to high density, basically. To do so with our simulation, what we have to do is, first of all, to reach the jump phase. So we start from our randomly distributed particle and we perform subsequent step of box reduction and energy minimization. Doing that, we take into account the value of pressure, and what we observed, and this is something that is already studied in other papers on jamming, is that if the pressure is zero, because the particle is basically unjammed, so you can compress the box and you have no resistance, basically, when they start to be attached one to the other, like in a solid, basically, now if you try to compress it again, the pressure increases. And this is the sign of a phase transition. So we observe at more or less this point, the beginning of the phase transition. And since we want to start from a jump phase, we decide to perform our simulation on the jump phase with a packing fraction of 0.87 to be sure that we are in a jump phase. And to have a better statistics, what we do is that we create 10 initial configuration like the one you can observe here. And okay, so now is what we have in our jammed simulation, and the movement you see are only due to thermal noise. The next step is to add the active torque, that is the meaning feature of our model. And as you can already see from those simple video, adding the active torque, the behavior changed dramatically. So if you are in a jam phase, now you see that the particle moves a lot. But we want to be more systematically and to better characterize this. And so what we did is that starting from the jam configuration we saw before, we gradually and systematically increased the value of the active torque. And what you observe in this snapshot, in which the particles are colored according to the angular velocity in the z-direction, you can see that increasing the active torque made the particle rotate more, and they form those regions of highly rotating particles. Even more, if you check the velocity distribution, you also see that the active torque we are adding acts in the direction we are expecting. So basically, if you look at the angular velocity, you see this double peak because we are adding plus or minus tau z according to the sign, as we said before. So this is why we have this double peak. But you can see the distribution is flattened, meaning that there are more particles with a non-zero value of the angular velocity, as you expect. And then, looking at the modulus of the linear velocity, you can see that increasing the value of the active torque increases the value of the velocity, so particles are moving more due to the presence of the active torque. And then, coming back again to our example of natural rotators, we performed an experiment with Chlamydomonas reinhardi at high density, and again from particular image velocimetry, we reconstruct a map of the angular velocity of the particles. And what we see again is that those algae rotate at single particle level, but not only, because they tend to form a cluster of rotating algae, and they have also this vortex-like behavior in which you can see algae rotating in the opposite direction, basically. Again, when you look at the shape of the velocity distribution, you can see that is something similar to what we obtained from our model. So again, the shape of the angular velocity is the same. We want to move a step further now. So science, okay, the models do what we expected. This is something consistent with the experiment. Now we start studying systematically the trajectory of those active particles, both in the simulated case and in the case of the algae. What we did, first of all, is to plot the trajectory. And in the two cases, in the case of Chlamydomonas and in the case of the simulations. And what you observe in the case of Chlamydomonas at high density is that the particle diffuse. And this diffusive behavior can be seen especially from the mean square displacement we extract from those trajectories. What we did in the simulation here, you can see the trajectory in the snapshot for a particle that is in the jammed phase. And you can see that the trajectory is very localized, so you have no diffusion. But when you increase the value of the active torque, as we have seen before, then you see that the particle have a clearly diffusive behavior. And this can be seen from the mean square displacement. So here, the mean square displacement is plotted for different value of the active torque. And you can clearly see that increasing the value of the active torque causes the mean square displacement to increase. Then, from our simulation in which we systematically increase the active torque, basically we perform a linear fit on the mean square displacement to obtain the diffusion coefficient. And analyzing it, what we see is that you have a sharp increase around tau z, around 4000, more or less, that is a symptom of a phase transition. So from a very a non-diffusing state, that is a jammed state, to a jammed one in which the particle diffuses. But we also wanted to consider, as we said in our model, the role of adhesion. So basically what we did, we consider the, again, the mean square displacement, this time varying the value of the Amaker constant, that is the constant that controls the strength of the adhesion, basically. So we are increasing the adhesion strength. And this time what we observe is that increasing the adhesion, the mean square displacement increase. So this time we have an opposite effect respect to what we had due to the active torque. So adhesion behaves in the opposite way. In fact, if we consider again the diffusion coefficient, we see that the particle are diffusing. The particle are diffusing because we have to consider that now, in the case of the adhesion, we have started our simulation from a value from particles that are rotating with an active torque, so they are in a jammed phase. So particles are in an unjammed phase. Then, when you increase the adhesion over a certain value, the diffusion coefficient dramatically drops to zero. And this is the sign of another phase transition, this time from an unjammed to a jammed state. But we wanted to move even farther, and what we wanted to do is to add another ingredient to our simulation, because okay, we look at the algae before, for example, the video we observe, okay, they are self-rotating, the rotation is a new ingredient that is very important, but they are also moving in the surrounding performing self-propulsion. So we have to take into account self-propulsion. So in our simulation, we take into account, we switch on the self-propulsion term that was switched off before. And what we observe, again, looking at the diffusion coefficient respect to the self-propulsion, this time when we have no active torque, is that at a certain value of the self-propulsion, the diffusion coefficient starts to be non-zero. And so that self-propulsion alone can lead to unjamming. This is something that was already observed in other active matter systems. But what it is interesting to analyze is the combined role of self-propulsion and self-rotation. In fact, if we take a certain value, a fixed value of self-propulsion, and we increase the self-rotation, we see that we have two different behaviors. At the beginning, the system is unjammed, then jammed, and then unjammed again. So taking all these ingredients and spanning the space of parameters in a systematical way, what we did is to build this phase diagram for bidimensional active rotators. And what we observe is that there are two different regions of unjamming. So the first one is this deep purple one, and this is something already known, because in this case we have an unjamming due to self-propulsion, and this is something already studied. Then the interesting stuff is that when you introduce the self-rotation, the system jams. Why? Because when you have self-propulsion, the system tends to undergo current collective motion, basically. But the introduction of self-rotation jams the system, because the self-rotation mixes up the system, so basically breaking the current motion. And so this is why you have unjamming. But when you increase self-rotation even more, then you have another region of unjamming, this time only due to the rotational the rotational part, so only due to the active torque that you are applying to the system. So basically you have these two different kind of unjamming, one due to the self-propulsion and one due to self-rotation. And this is the main result, I would say, of our paper. And so to conclude, what we observe with what we analyze in this study is that from the experimental point of view, the analysis of a natural example of active rotators like Chlamydomonas reinhardi shows that this kind of algae can not only self-rotate as was already known, but they can also aggregate and forming collectively rotating clusters. So this behavior is very interesting. And then from the point of view of the statistical physics, let's say, we observed that self-rotation alone is able to cause a phase transition from a jammed to unjammed solid-like state. And again, the adhesion can act in the opposite direction. So adhesion can turn a system from an unjammed to a jammed phase. And so these are the main results of our topics. And I want to thank for this work all the members of the Center of Complexity and Weave System groups that work on this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Linda, for the presentation. Is there any question? If anybody shows up?
Hi, hi, Linda.
Hi.
I just want to ask a curiosity.
Yeah.
When you show the role of the adhesion, when you increase the adhesion, you see a sharp drop in the diffusion.
Yes.
I was thinking why the such drop, such sharp drop instead of a linear decrease. So what happens in the correspondence of this drop? Do you have an idea of the physical reason of this?
Well, probably the fact is that until a certain point, the adhesion is not that is don't have enough strength to balance the other interaction among particles. Basically, at a certain point, I think it becomes comparable with the interaction among the particles. I think that this is the causes of this very rapid drop.
There is a clustering, maybe impacting this.
Not exactly.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So I also have a curiosity, more biological one.
Okay.
This model is tailor-made for algae, or there are other biological active matter that you can study using?
Let's say we started from algae because, okay, Chlamydomonas are not only the only example of rotating algae. For example, so the bulbous alga can form these cluster that collectively rotating. But what we actually had in mind is that, for example, also epithelial cells, for example, in some experiments in which they are confined in narrow channels, you can observe the formation of a kind of vorticity. And this is something that makes us think that this rotational behavior can in some way be important, can play a role when you have to study the cell invasion and cell migration. So even in epithelial tissue, you have the formation of these vortex-like behavior and collective rotations.
Okay, thank you. Is there any other question? Or, okay. Otherwise, we can thank Linda, and I thank you all for participating to this virtual seminar. And see you to the next one.
So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.